Hearty welcome to you all students, and today we are going to continue the previous class lesson titled as A Lost Spring, upper class 12th, and this is the second lesson of our main textbook. So already I had given you introduction, so let me continue the first part of this particular lesson titled as A Lost Spring. Dear students, the title of the lesson is Lost Spring, whereas this lesson is also having a subtitle, and subtitle of this lesson is Stories of a Stolen Childhood. And these stories of a stolen childhood under the name of a title Lost Spring is written by the great Indian writer Anish Jain. And today we are going to deal with the first part of this story. And the first part of the story as having title, Sometimes I Find a Rupee in the Garbage. So this is the story, the first story. Actually, this lesson comprises the two stories, and the first part of that story is having a title, Sometimes I Find Garbage. Sometimes I Find a Rupee in the Garbage. So this is the first part of the story. Dear students, here this picture gives you an idea about a childhood, and as all of you know that the childhood of a human life is often likened to a spring, as it marks the beginning of a human life and also has a tremendous scope for growth. It is an age full of joy, pleasure and play. Children anywhere in the world are a source of a great joy. But ironically, millions of children, like the rag picker Sahib and the bangle maker Mukesh, are forced to do the work at the early tender age of their life. And because of that, their own childhood is going to be consumed in making a living. And the main reason for that, education, play and pleasure, these are the things which are they are going to miss, because instead of getting an education, instead of enjoying the life by playing and having a pleasure, they start doing the work in the blossoming periods of their life. And they must work because they are compelled to do so because of their own family condition. So one such pathetic story of a child who is a rag picker are going to deal today. And prior to plunge into that story, let me tell you something about a rag pickers. So usually, dear students, a rag pickers are mostly extremely poor. They are illiterate and they belong to a rural immigrant families. So many commence their profession at the very young age of 5 or even at 8 years, and most of them never attend any kind of a school or any formal kind of a education. And the family of a rag pickers are in need of a money, in need of a extra income from these young children. And one such rag picker by name Later onwards, we would like to come to know his name, because his name is also having an irony in it. Dear students, so this story, as it is begin, wait in searching for a gold in the garbage. That means there is rag pickers are going to search a gold in the garbage. So gold here is nothing but the things which are essential for their life, and garbage had is going to give an opportunity for them to get the source of that life, because it provides their daily bread and their life totally depends upon it. And that's why garbage is going to provide a source, and whatever that source they are going to get, that is going to be called as gold. And they are always scrounging, searching for that such kind of a gold which they may feel, because later onwards, after collecting those things, they will go and sell it, and after selling they will get a meager amount with which they can take care of their life. So here the narrator comes across one such rag picker boy, and narrator was in the habit of going a walk every morning, and in the dawn, at the dawn of the day, the group of such rag pickers are roaming here and there in search of a gold in a garbage. So one such rag picker was also met a narrator, and he is searching for gold in the garbage dumps, because garbage dumps are everything for these children, and their life itself begins, the day itself begins by associating with the garbage, and the garbage which we feel sometimes a blotted stink in the mankind itself. Even we may not be able to go near by the garbage, even we can't get a smell of it also, but these rag pickers, they are totally adjusted themselves with the foul smell of the garbage, and they are working every day with the garbage only. So most of these rag pickers, they came from Dhaka. Dhaka is the capital city of Bangladesh. And as far as this particular rag picker boy whom the narrator met, he doesn't know anything about his old home. And it was said that he came from Dhaka, and Arthur had got an idea, but here the boy is trying to sponge a gold in the heaps of the garbage, and Arthur asks him why he does that. And that was a question which the Arthur had posed or raised to him, and at that time that rag picker boy mutters that he has nothing else to do. And when she asked about his place from where he had come, he told the Dhaka, but he don't know anything about the Dhaka. So he doesn't go to the school, because there is no school in his neighborhood, and the only work he knows, that is picking up the rags. And that's why every day, by waking up early in the morning, the rag pickers in a group, they move from one place to another place in search of the things which they needed, which they want. And the rag pickers of a this particular place are very much in the need of their livelihood of a bread and butter, so that with that they can able to take care. And education is totally out of their reach, because getting a single day meal itself is a great problem for them. So here, as the boy was heavily burdened with the things, because as much as he carries, the more weight he will get, somewhat more money. So with that more money, he was supposed to take care of his life. And this is how, at the very early tender age, that rag picker boy had started doing the work of carrying a loads of garbage segregated, because these things, they are going to sell it out for a recycling purpose. And for that purpose, he was carrying over here. So usually, after some time, the narrator, she asked the name of that boy. And when narrator asked the name of a boy, the boy uttered that his name as Saheb-e-Alam. That was his name. And literally speaking, the meaning of a Saheb-e-Alam, even the boy who is a Saheb-e-Alam don't know at all. And the meaning of Saheb-e-Alam is the Lord of Universe. That is what the literal meaning of the boy. But totally, he was opposite of his own name. And the Lord of the Universe, instead of being in a lodge, roaming from garbage to garbage to collect the waste materials, the waste thing which are thrown as dirt. And that is what the irony of a life of that particular rag picker boy named as Saheb-e-Alam. But that Saheb, a rag picker boy, doesn't know what does it mean by his own name. And that is what the innocence, that is what the thing in which they were compelled to lead their life itself. So Saheb, that's why rummaging from one garbage to another in search of the things. And this is only the means of survival. Sometimes he may able to find enough, and sometimes even he may faces a problem of not getting anything. But the boy who was so much pathetic, the literal meaning of the name of the boy itself is Lord of the Universe. But irony is that he is forced to work as rag picker. So after some days, the narrator acquainted with this group of rag picker, and even narrator also promised that if at all she starts a school, whether Saheb-e-Alam will join that school. So happily that the boy was ready. And after some days, the boy suddenly one day asked back a question to the narrator whether her school was ready, because he is interested. And at that time, the narrator felt very much awkward for giving such kind of a hollow promise to the boy, because it's very difficult for a narrator to construct or to build the school. So here actually these rag pickers boys are moving from one place to another place, and as they are moving from one place to another place, they are not at all having any footwears. They are not at all using it, and this happens, and the whole rag pickers, they don't have any chappals or any footwears to cover up their feet, and that's why they are roaming. And because of that one, even the group of those rag pickers is called as an army of a barefoot boys. So this army of a barefoot boys, they work right from the morning and disappear at the afternoon, because they can able to get the things whatever they want if they goes early in the morning, because even there also a lot of competition is there to get the things, and that's why they will work and they will be very active early in the morning, and by the afternoon they will go back and they will sell the things whatever they had collected it. And almost all these rag pickers, they live in utter poverty. Poverty in which they are leading their life, and that is going to force them, that is going to compel, the poverty itself is going to compel them to do the work at the early tender age of their life. They can't even afford to wear the footwears, shoes or chappals, and that is what the reason, that's the reason for them to move without wearing any kind of a footwear. And due to that also, they are called as an army of a bare foot. And when narrator asked to this sahib, one of another friend told that the mother had kept the footwear or the shoes at the self, and she may not going to allow them to wear. But in actual reality, these rag pickers never get a chance to wear the footwear, and being a barefoot itself become a tradition, and even some of them said that they don't want to break the tradition, rather they want to continue it. So most of the rag pickers, like a sahib, in this way remain as shoeless, and they are roaming, wandering from place to place without wearing a chappal at all. So when all these things is going to happen, narrator, because this is how the narrator is going to spend time talking in an informal way, and in their talk the narrator gathered a lot of information, and suddenly the narrator recalled one such a story, and that story is from the man from Udupi. And according to the story which was recalled by the narrator, it provides an insight into a changing poverty. How do that poverty keep on changing? And that's why she told one story of a man from Udupi who was a priest's son, and that priest's son always woke up early in the morning, and he used to make a prayer the God to bless with the pair of shoes. And later, after some years, the narrator visited the same temple where she had been earlier, and now the things are quite changed. So he came across the son of the new priest, and suddenly when she saw that son of a new priest, that son, instead of asking or praying the God for shoes, he was wearing a gray socks and shoes already. That means the priest's son, means he got an opportunity, or he is blessed with the shoes and socks. So that's why he need not to pair now to the God to give him a shoes. So in this way, shoes are now easily available for the priest's son, and that's why he had stopped praying for it. Rather, he want to request the God, let he should not, leave those shoes, and that is what let the God may protect those things. But however, there is still certain section of Indian society who are struggling a lot with the poverty on a daily basis, and their condition has not been improved so far. They are still in a very utter poverty, and those people are the rag pickers. They still walk without wearing a shoes, without wearing a chappals or the footwear, and they keep on walking on a bare foot. And this is not a tradition at all. This is the circumstances or the condition in which they are compelled to face the life as it is. And that is what the harsh reality the narrator recalled with the story from a man of Udupi. And this one such story she recalled at the moment when she saw the army of a barefoot boys of a rag picker. So all these rag pickers, basically they are from a place called Simapuri. So Simapuri is within the periphery of Delhi, and as we all know that Delhi is a capital city of our country, and it is natural to expect that the capital city should have been in a good condition compared to the other places. And this is what the map of Simapuri. This map gives a clear cut location, and here you can able to see the Shastri Park. Here you can see Bholanath Nagar, or even sometimes the Rajghat is also there. So amidst of that Delhi itself, there is one place called Simapuri. So these are the house or homes which are there in that place, and mainly they are made up of mud, tarpaulin, and even tins are used. So Simapuri is a home of all these rag pickers, and most of these rag pickers, they live in that Simapuri which is there in Delhi, and it was estimated that there are around 10,000 rag pickers just like a Sahib living in Simapuri, and they live in the slum. And a slum, that means you know it very well. Those structures, the earlier pictures which I had shown you, that itself gives you clear-cut indication. And the structures of muds with the roofs of tin and tarpaulin we had already seen. And as far as development or progress is concerned, there is no sign of any development or progress in this place. There is no proper service system, the drainage system is not at all there, even there is no facility of water. And within this Sanctuary area, more than 10,000 rag pickers are living over there since last 30 years. And all these people, mostly they came from Bangladesh in the year 1971. Most of the rag pickers of the Simhapuri were from Bangladesh. And that's why they are also called as migrants of Bangladesh. Maybe it is during the course of war or because of the flood, just in order to have a bright hopes and future, they thought better to migrate towards the cities, and that's why they thought that Delhi is the safest place for them to provide that kind of opportunity. And as many as more than 10,000 rag pickers, we can able to find it from the place called Simhapuri, and most of them from the Bangladesh. These people, they don't have any kind of identity, they don't have even a permit to stay within our country, but still all of them, they have a ration card, and the ration card will enable them to give a vote at the time of our election. And not only they will get a chance of casting a vote, even they will get a subsidized ration and grains through which they can able to satisfy or to feed their hungry stomach. So identity or a permission or any kind of a card is not more important for them. Instead, the food is more important than the identity, and that is how the life of these people. So they have lived there, and they have right to vote. With the ration cards only they are getting a grain, and food is more important for survival than the identity. Wherever they find a food, they pitch their tents and become the transit homes. So in these conditions, the people are leading their life itself. And as these people are living such kinds of a indignant life, and here let me show you the picture, the aerial view of this particular place called Simhapuri. This is what the aerial view of a Simhapuri, which is there in Delhi, but it is far away from Delhi as far as development or progress is concerned. And you can see those houses or tents which are made up of muds with the roof of a tins. And this is what the place called Delhi Simhapuri, which is totally far away from the reality of a life itself. And the condition of these people is very pathetic. And this is another picture of such kinds of slum area where all these rag pickers are living over there. And Sahib-e-Alam is also one among such a rag picker boy who was living in Simhapuri. So the people who are living over there, survival means a rag picking. Rag picking is the only work, and it is only a profession which these people mostly they knew it. And garbage, as it was thought, is a gold for them, and they earn their daily bread and butter of their life with this particular thing, by searching a gold in the garbage. And like this, most of the children in this particular place, Simhapuri, they are growing up in a very unhygienic condition.
And when they are born and brought up in such kinds of condition, even their growth is also going to be stunted. Okay, and they may not able to get whatever they want in their life. And the children become the partners in a survival of those elders. And survival in these particular place means only a rag picking. And rag picking has, with the due course of time, had acquired the position of a fine art, and in that they become a very expert picking the rags and collecting, gathering it, and again selling it in order to get a money to satisfy their hunger of a stomach. So that's why garbage naturally becomes a goal to them, and that's why majority of their time they are spending within the garbage searching the things which they want. Sometimes while children are collecting the things out of the garbage, they will find a silver coin, sometimes they will find rupees, a 10 rupees note, and whenever they will get it, instantly they felt very happy, apart from the things which they are collecting. And that's why garbage becomes a wonderful thing for these children, and it is wrapped it within itself, the wonders, and those wonders the children want to have it in their life, and that's why they are very much closely associated with the wonder of a garbage, because it is wrapped up with the wonder. But whereas it is a wonderful wrapped up thing, but for elders it is the means of a survival, because their life is totally depends upon the garbage. Okay, and in this way the same garbage is having a different meaning to the children as well as the elders. So like this, so many days have passed, and one day the boy Sahib-e-Alam was wearing a tennis shoes, and after wearing the tennis shoes he was just came over there in order to collect the rags. But one fine morning he just stood at one hockey club gate, just at the fence was there, and he was standing and he was looking at the people who are playing the tennis at the time, the very two young men dressed up in a very white dress, and they are playing the game called tennis. But whereas Sahib is also wearing a tennis shoes during that time, but whatever the tennis shoes he was wearing, they are discarded, they are rejected shoes of some rich boy, because that rich boy, he refused to wear them due to a hole is there in one of the shoes, and for that reason that the rich boy had thrown it, and luckily the boy Sahib-e-Alam got it, and he was delighted to wear that particular holed shoes, and by wearing that he was eagerly watching at the moments of the two young men who were playing at tennis in the court. And he can't enter inside it also, because it is having a fence, and the game which he was watching, he was very much fond of playing, but he don't know that the tennis is a game of a rich people and a poor can't able to play at all. But still the Sahib has having a hope, and he has having a dream by wearing a shoes hole. Tennis shoes itself is just like a dream come true, and he was felt very much satisfied, at least if not by playing a tennis, at least
he felt joyful by getting the wearing this kind of a shoes at all. So, dear students, prior to this, I would like to show you one particular video of the place called Simhapuri. And this Simhapuri is a place, and what kind of a lifestyle at that place is going to. This video will give you just kind of watch it so that we can continue our story.
India's most familiar images. By 5 in the morning, lakhs of men, women and children set out towards rubbish dumps and landfills to rummage through the mountains of garbage, their aim to find waste material that can be recycled. These are India's rag pickers. Who for generations have been part of an informal waste management system.
I will not be wrong if I say 70 to 80% of waste of this country is being picked up by rag pickers. Rag pickers are not being paid by the government authority. They charge household maybe around 30 rupees, 40 rupees, 50 rupees per month. They collect waste. They segregate waste which is of value to them.
There are 2 million rag pickers across India. A large section concentrated in the big cities. Delhi, NCR region and Mumbai have a population of 3.5 lakhs. And of the total population of rag pickers, 1.2 lakh children are actually under the age of 14. Manirul is 11 years old. We first meet him at the Vivekanand campsite.
Beta, idhar aao. Aap baat karoge?
He's shy and he knows that child labor laws make his work illegal, but is willing to take us home at the Kabadi Basti in Chanakyapuri, Delhi.
क्या करते हो आप फिर दिन भर
ऐसे कूड़ा बीनते हो
कूड़ा बीनते हो और कुछ पैसे इकट्ठे कर लेते हो
हाँ
तो तीनों भाई एक साथ जाते हो
नहीं दो भाई जाता है तीन मूर्ति जाता है इधर नाचा वाचा तो सब जगह घूमते हैं
और फिर आके फिर बीनते भी हो कि नहीं बस आके दे देते हो फिर पापा करते काम
लॉस पीपल ऑफ दिस बस्ती टेल अस डोंट फैक्टर इन इकोनॉमिक रियलिटीज Manirul's entire family has been involved in rag picking. It's the only livelihood they've known for generations. And without each person's work, the family will not survive. Even Aslatun, Manirul's sister, who is lucky to go to school, spends most of her time out of class, rummaging through waste.
So this is how these people are doing at around 1.2 lakh children are there who are engaged in a rag picking activity throughout our country, which is a national shame itself. So, survival for all these rag picking itself is a art of rag picking, is the only skill which they know, and due to that, all these people, they are trying their level best to do, and that's why they are engaged themselves by early in the morning. They will still work at the afternoon, by the afternoon when they collect it as much as possible, they will move in order to sell it. And this is one such story of boy called Sahib, because by watching the two men who are playing the tennis, even he too also got a desire of hope of playing the game, but he don't know that the game which he was watching, it was totally out of his reach, because it is a game of a rich, and with wearing one particular tennis shoes with a hole, he felt his dream come true, at least by putting on the tennis shoes which is discarded. So one fine winter morning, the narrator was just passing through and she saw Nauda Sahib, and Sahib is not at all now lifting the bag and collecting the garbage. Rather, he got a new job, and that way a small job, working in a tea stop. And that is what the new job the Sahib-e Alam had got it, and that's why narrator had came to know that Sahib got that small job and he is earning now monthly by doing the work in a tea stall, and per month he used to get a salary of 800 rupees, and apart from that all the meals he is getting free of cost. But while working in the tea stall, he lost his carefree look, and that is what the narrator had noticed it, because the milk steel canister which the boy Sahib is carrying, it belongs to the master, and it is seems that canister or the milk canister itself is heavier than the plastic bag which he used to hang on his shoulder. But the bag which he carry on his shoulder, that plastic bag belongs to the Sahib, but whereas the milk canister now which he lifts and carries, that belongs to the shop owner. So because of that, Sahib is no longer his own master, and he lost that carefree look, and even he lost his freedom also. And this is what the narrator felt it when she met a Sahib one fine winter morning. So Sahib was got a new job, but still he misses the freedom. He lost his freedom of a life, because he's totally mastered, commanded under the owner of a tea stall, and due to that only he lost the carefree look. So this is what the pathetic story of one such rag picker boy named as Sahib-e Alam. So dear students, this is what the mind map. So this mind mapping will help you to get the glance of the gist of the complete story called Sometimes I Find a Rupees in the Garbage. So here, author's encounter with a Sahib, when the author encounter, these are the things which comes up in the mind, questions him about his vacation, then she came to know that it's a rag picking, and even she advised him to the go school. But when the next time rag picker met, he asked about the school, and because of that she got annoyed. And even the author come to know that most of the rag pickers, they belong to the refugee family who came from Bangladesh, and as he promised to open the school, it was not happened. When he asks, he felt very much embarrassed. The irony in his name also, we came to know that his name is Sahib-e Alam. The meaning of it is a Lord of Universe, but in reality he is totally different. Okay, so passage of time, degree of prosperity achieved, longing for fair upper shoes, right, because still become shoeless. These are things, the irony. And Simapuri, the place where most of these rag pickers are living, dwelling structures of the mud, the roofs which are made up of tins and tarpaulin, and only the people want to have a ration cards, they don't have any identity card, for getting a food is a more important for them instead of having an identity. And Sahib's longingness to wear the shoes, watch the rich boys who are playing the tennis, wish to play and to have that pleasure, but that particular game is totally out of his reach. And then finally Sahib was able to get a new job of working in a tea stall, getting a small salary of 800 per month, 800 rupees per month, including all meals. But now he was getting a money, he was getting a food, but still he can't able to enjoy that particular work, and he seems to be appeared burdened for lunch because no freedom was there. Tin canister is heavier than his earlier rag picking bag itself. So this is how the whole gist of the lesson is captured in this particular mind mapping. Dear students, kindly go through all these points, because these are the bullet points which are going to help us to know the story completely. So with this we come to the end of today's online class, and if at all you have any queries or the question, you keep on posting it in our WhatsApp group, or you may contact me also in order to clarify your doubt. So today is online offline class. This is Mr. Rakesh D. Nadkarni of Jawahar Navodaya Vidyalaya Shankar Nagar going to express in-depth thanks to each one of you. Thank you all. So see you again tomorrow with the next part of this story titled as I Want to Drive a Car. Bye bye. See you tomorrow.